Hello again, I'm Larry Hamilton. Welcome to my YouTube painting channel. Thank you for watching. Today we're going to do an oil painting, which we haven't done for quite a while. I've taken the summer off pretty much and done several watercolors. I hope you enjoyed those. We're going to do a fall scene that I picked up from some photographs that I purchased. Nice little scene with some trees and some water and pretty simple basically. But I'm going to take you through the whole process except for gessoing the panel that I have. And we'll start with the sketch. I don't have a sketch up here yet. So you're going to get to see me try to sketch it from the photograph that I have. And then we'll start the painting. So let's go over the brushes first. I've got a series of brushes I'm going to use today. A series of flats and filberts. I won't go through all of those. I think they're... I'll talk about them as I use each brush, but basically they're a different set of brushes than I've used in the past. As most of you know, I've used Bob Ross oil paints and Bob Ross brushes with a few Grumbacher brushes or Dick Blick brushes added. Today I'm going to use a whole different set of brushes. I'm going to use a whole different set of paints. So I'm keeping the scene we're painting fairly simple, but I'm going to be experimenting with some Gamblin paints and some different brushes that I've purchased, and I'll tell you what they are when I pick them up. Let me go over the palette very quickly here and show you what colors we're using. These are all Gamblin paints with the exception of one or two colors. I have titanium white, I have ultramarine blue, cobalt blue, ivory black, burnt umber, dark burnt sienna, alizarin crimson, which is not a Gamblin color, and I have sap green, viridian, cadmium yellow, yellow ochre, and then I have a cadmium red over here. I also have ultramarine violet from Grumbacher. Some of my paints are running down the my glass palette here, as you can see. I'll try to keep them from getting too far away here. Hopefully this will won't be too distracting, but I paint with a vertical palette here, and I like for you to be able to see the colors. I like to be able to overlay the palette on the video when I'm painting so you can actually see them. So I let them run a little bit here and just try to work with it. Anyway, with that said, let me go back here and start on the sketch. Let me zoom in first with my camera controls here and see if I can get this lined up for you. About there, I think. And let's see, maybe a little bit that way. Okay, I think we're set. And I will get started here. So I don't have a sketch on here. I do have a few marks that I've made. This has sort of helped me as I do this live, real time here, that I can know where some key points are, like the water line here. It's going to be here. I'm going to make it go this way, up to a little point here. Comes back, and there's a nice big yellow trees over here, bushy trees here. There's a pretty interesting couple of trees here. I'm going to try to make them a little more interesting than they actually are by just using non-linear lines for these trees. And they sort of bush out, come up this way into the sky. A lot of sky holes in here. I'm going to try to preserve some sky holes. The trees behind them are sitting back here in this area. They have a nice up and down feel to them here. Then we start getting into some other trees that are on the other side of the bank over here. So then there's the water line that goes here. This water kind of goes around a little peninsula here and sits back. So this will be a nice thing to show the another set of trees in this area that I want to highlight right in here. And then this bank comes down like this and goes up. Got some dark trees in here. There's some really dark shapes over here that I want to capture. Lead the dark shape. There's dark shapes on the bottom of this bank along here I want to capture. I got some really nice reflections in the water. There's some trees that are actually falling down into the water here. Try to capture that if I can. Then there's some other little pine trees here. Then there's several of these large whole forest of trees over here. I'm not trying to draw every tree, but I want to sort of make it bushy and just leave some sky holes or be some sky holes in here. I'll actually draw some abstract shapes for you to see that I'm going to try to leave some areas that I don't paint around, if I can remember that. The other part of the bank goes over here. It kind of takes off where this water, this log goes into the water. And don't make this a straight line. One of the painters that I follow very religiously has got some great books, great website, and gives some very good videos. He charges for his lessons, but they're worth it to me. I have another log that goes across here. Anyway, I was saying that the artist that I follow for many of my ideas and many of the things I try to relate to you, his name is Johannes Floathaus. And I try to take as many of his video workshops as I can. And I try to follow his painting techniques as much as I can. Okay, there we go. I think that's going to do it for the sketch. I also have a value map that I've created. I'll put that on the video when I edit it so that you can see the value map, which shows where the dark areas are. I'm going to have dark in here, kind of dark in the background here. This bank is going to be dark. Got some dark trees here. A few darks over there. The sky is going to be the lightest area. Try to make a nice abstract shape out of that sky. Don't just cut it off with vertical and angular and triangular trees. All the sky holes should have an abstract shape so they don't look like they're too contrived. Even though they may look that way in a photograph, don't paint them that way. Use abstract shapes everywhere. All right, let's get going. I'm going to grab my one of my bigger brushes. I also have picked up a little bit of liquid white, which you know comes from the Bob Ross set of paints, and I've kind of used that to slow down the drying process a little bit. And then I also have some liquid on a paper plate here that I may use to sort of speed up the drying process. So let's see if we can get going with some of this. I'm going to start out with a very light sky, using a little bit of this titanium white and a little bit of this cobalt blue to start laying in the sky. The liquid white will make the paint flow, as you know, if you've watched me before. But I want to just put in some people say you should paint the sky first, others say paint the sky last. I don't think it really matters too much, but you certainly want to get it in there as much as you can, especially these sky holes. We'll paint around some of those with the other colors as I come in here, but get a nice background. Pick up just a tad of red in there. Maybe I don't like that red. I'll make a little bit of a alizarin to sort of redden it up a little bit. That's a little too red. More cobalt blue, more white. So let's just put in this sky as much as we can here. Down here, get some more paint. A little bit more liquid white. Liquid white, by the way, I should say, is, people wonder what it is. Bob Ross invented it when he was painting his PBS video series, because he had to get a painting. He got a large painting finished in like 26 minutes on PBS television, so he had to move fairly quickly. So he used this idea of liquid white. He called it liquid white. It's really just titanium white with about a 50% mixture of another medium or linseed oil or something to thin it down and make it flow and move on the canvas a lot easier and faster. So he would always use a humongous brush and put large skies in a lot of times and would do it very quickly. And it was really because he was constrained by the time of the video. He had a 30-minute program he had to record, and he had to get it done in 30 minutes. So he actually had 26 minutes or so to get it done. And he did, but he invented using these big brushes. He invented this liquid white, and a lot of his paints are still around, widely sold, widely used by a lot of people. He has been gone since 1995, I believe, but his family still carries on his painting videos and supplies, and you can find them readily on most artist stores. Let's see, this is going to come down. Okay, so I'm trying to make this, if you look here what I'm leaving, I'm doing negative painting now around the trees areas. And I've painted where the sky holes in the trees are supposed to be, so that when I get to that, I'll leave those areas out. I have a little ultra blue here. I'm going to mix a little bit of that in and try to change the color a little bit of the blues in some places. If I get enough blue, I'll do that. It has a more of a purple cast. So the blues I have on my palette are, one is has purple in it. That's the ultra blue, and you can see that here where I put it on very heavily. The other one has a little more green in it. And, cobalt blue tends to lean toward the blue shade a little bit. And you can even put a little of viridian in there if you want to sort of get some green in the sky. Most people don't want green in the sky, but the sky does reflect some of the ground colors if you have green. We don't have a lot of green in this painting. We have a lot of yellows and oranges and browns and so forth, ochres. Okay, so let's just leave this like this. Maybe I'll come back and put just a couple of hints of some clouds in here with some bigger brush strokes, maybe. Let's do that. Touch of shadow. Pick up a little ivory black here and put in a few things that sort of make it look like there's more going on in that sky than just pure clouds and blue sky background. Okay, something like this. Hopefully that's coming through to you well on the video. All right, so much for the sky. Using this big brush, this is like a 1-inch brush. It's a, not really a bristle, it's a synthetic brush. Most of the brushes I'm going to use today are synthetic. So I'll tell you what they are here as we go on. Okay, let's take a little bit of this liquid white. I'm going to, while I've got it here, I'm going to put it in where this water is going to go down here. So I have some areas that I want to blend later, just to remind me where the water is going to go. Like right in here, there's going to be water across here. All across here is going to have water. This whole foreground is really water. So I'm just going to kind of lay this in now, and it'll just remind me of where things are going to go over here. And I'll have a little base coat on the canvas. I didn't tell you what I'm painting on today. The painting surface is not it's not a canvas stretch canvas. It's a canvas panel, and it's 12 by 16. And so it has a canvas type surface, but it's really on a board. You can see as I push it, it sort of bends a little bit. But it doesn't have the give in the center like a stretch canvas would. Most stretch canvases, when you push them here, they sink in, but this board is solid. So there's gonna be water going back there like that. Water here. All right, so that's about as messy as I want to make it right now for you. Okay, next step. Get some more paper towel here. Clean out my brush a little bit. And let's get going on some of these trees that are sort of in the background. I'm going to pick up a flat. This is a catalyst brush by Princeton. It's a black synthetic brush. It's sold by Dick Blick and other manufacturers, but it's called a polytip bristle brush flat. It's synthetic bristle. So we're going to start with some yellows and oranges here for these trees in the background. If I need a little bit of medium to thin my paint, I'm going to use this liquin. But we'll start in this area back here. Throw up some bright yellow colors here. Throw some of those in along there. There's a lot of them over here. Some really bright yellows over here in this area. Just lay it in. The canvas I mentioned to you is a 12 by 16. It's also pre-coated. I coated it with a coat of gray gesso, which happens to be one of the gessos that you can buy that's a Bob Ross color. Bob Ross sells those. So I'm just laying in some nice orange trees here. Change that, maybe we'll get a little green in there in some areas. We'll start getting a little green. Not a lot of green in this painting. I don't know why I put so much green on my palette, but we'll come back and put some branches in there. So let's just kind of push and pull, twist and turn. Maybe some sap green. Sap green is this particular sap green has a bit of olive look to it in my from the colors that I've used before. Pick up some browns over here. Start throwing in a little bit of the burnt sienna. Okay. Over here we start getting in some browns. Let's see. Get a few other colors, lighten some of this up. We'll get some with some, add some white to it. So I'll go back and pick up some darker browns now. Let's see if we can get some of this back here, sort of block in some of these areas where we're going to have trees and the trunks go back here. We'll come back and define that a little better later, but right now I just want to get some blocking in done. Probably should be doing a little less specific painting, a little more blocking in some of these other areas as well. Let me see if I can get some. These oranges over here. A lot of orange in that. A little too much. So I'm just going to start putting in some of this and we'll come back and fine-tune that later. Get the feel for that orange. I want to put a little more orange on this left side here to sort of tie it together. I don't want it to be identical on both sides, but I don't want to leave out the color from one side to the other. All right. Let's go back and pick up some browns. I haven't really cleaned this brush out very much. I haven't cleaned it out at all, actually, since I picked it up. But we're going to have some dark trees in here, some more yellows. I'm just going to sort of block some of this in with my browns. And we'll come back and fix that all up later. Darker stuff in here. Let's get some darker ones on the left side. Maybe we've got some really dark work going on the bank over here. This is the comes out like this. It comes up under that log. Okay. Have a little bit on this side over here as well. Some darks in here. We're going to have some more darks going up here. Let's see, that's a big set of trees in there. That's all right. I'm not trying to exactly copy the photograph because the photograph really distorts the colors, not the colors, but the values. Most digital cameras, this is a nice little secret that probably not many instructors will tell you, but the digital cameras have a tendency to sort of gray down, not gray down, but average out the grays in an image. So they try to sort of come up with an average color when they're showing you an image, and they tend to make the darks very, very dark, sometimes almost black on the photograph. They make the whites too white, the darks too dark. So if you don't know that and you start painting, trying to copy that photograph, you're going to be painting something that you wouldn't see out in nature, particularly when you're painting landscapes. When you see what a photograph looks like, and then if you're out there with your eyes, you didn't what you see with your eyes is not what the camera will record. Just the nature of the way the cameras are designed, the digital imaging sensors and the software algorithms that are used to determine what colors there are tend to average out the values so that you don't get the true colors you see in nature, because there are an infinite number of values and colors in nature. So when you're looking at a scene, it will not look the same as if you take the photograph of it. So you have to think about that when you're painting from photographs. So I'm trying to do that for you here. So my painting will not look exactly like the photograph in terms of color and or value. So remember that. Using one brush here, I'm going to go back and stick in some more tree. Stuff here. All right, so I've got a lot of that covered in. That's what I wanted to do, make sure I leave some good abstract shapes sitting in there. Over here as well. At some point during the painting process, I really stopped looking at the photograph. I just start reacting to what's on the canvas or what's on the paper if I'm doing watercolors. And paint a nice, pleasing scene. This big bush here is just all yellow. Almost pure cad yellow here. I'm going to block it in. Pick up a little bit of my liquid white to get it to flow a little better. All right, the color I haven't used yet is purple, and I need to get some violet in here. I'm gonna pick up another one of these Princeton catalyst brushes. This is a bright. It's a number 6 bright. The flat I was using was also a number 6. So you can see the widths are very similar. One, the bright has a flat has the longer bristles in this case, and the bright has the shorter bristles. Usually brights have a longer bristle. I'm going to pick up some of this violet on a different brush and start laying it in to start defining some shadows and some contour in these trees. In this area back here, I definitely want this violet to come out because I want to make this a lot more, have a little more depth back here. So I'm going to put in some areas that look like I've got some fog maybe, or something back here that's just by mixing those colors a little bit, you can get some depth in there. Starts looking sort of mysterious back in there. Some darker colors at the bottom. Always when you paint landscapes, trees, the vertical part of the tree always should be darker than the tops or the horizontal parts. When you paint trees, the horizontal tops usually reflecting the sky, but the vertical parts are not getting as much sunlight, so they tend to be darker in value. Not black, but darker. So we're going to go put in a few more areas here to sort of give ourselves this look of a woods over here with some darks in there. All right, let me step back for a second and get a view and see if that's looking the way I want it to. Sure. All right, now here we have a few other colors. We have this bank touches the water. See if I can get some of this darker color over here. We got some areas that need to have a little bit more darkness over here. It's almost too bright. I don't want the edges of this painting to be bright, and I don't want to take your eye off the painting with bright reflective things on the edges. The artist I'm talking to you about that I followed, Johannes Floathaus, his last name is spelled VLOTHUIS, but it's pronounced Floathaus. He's from Canada, and he has a website called improvemypaintings.com. I certainly recommend that you check that out and check out his painting style and check out his videos, DVDs. He is an artist who's been working with North Light Publishing for nearly 5 years, or over 5 years, I want to say. And they've selected him to give a lot of online classes. He gives streaming videos of live classes. And he has many DVDs. But a lot of the tips and secrets that I'm sharing with you are the ones I've learned from him. And I think he's very worth watching and learning from, because he certainly has done a lot of plein air painting, and he has followed the work. He refers to other artists that he's learned from, like Clyde Aspavig, Eric, I forget his last name now, a couple of artists that I recognize that I know he has worked with. Richard Schmidt is one that he refers to often. That's another painter that paints impressionistic. What you're seeing here is impressionistic painting, folks. This is not realism or photorealism. If you want photorealism, I say get a camera. If you want impressionistic artistic work, paint in watercolors or oils. You can get some very nice impressionistic artistic views that way. You can't get with a camera. painting it behind this bush now. I should have painted that before I put this on. But anyway, this is sort of my little peninsula. It's going to stick out here. Got another one over here. Let's see, get some of these ochres and oranges and yellows. And this cad red is really a potent color. It just really eats up your color palette. A little bit of it goes a very, very long way. I put way too much on my palette, but a lot of bushes in here. I'll come back and touch some of those up with some other colors. Pick up some purples and throw in here. So this is the blocking in stage, pretty much. When you get through the blocking in, it's sort of an ugly looking painting, and you think they'll never will never look like anything. But we're not through. Okay, let's see, there's some dark greens in there. A few dark greens over here. Pick up a little of this yellow, blue, and purple, black. Come down this way. We've got I'm using greens that at least I've used sap green before, but I haven't used the viridian very much. Viridian's a very potent color as well, and it tends to overshadow and eat the colors on your palette, just sort of taking over. Throwing a little bit of that over here to sort of balance out the painting, add some harmony. And let's see if I can get a nice color for these evergreens. We have a couple of evergreen trees here that I want to put in. Using a little phthalo, or viridian. Did I say phthalo green? I meant viridian. Sometimes I don't hear myself talk. Add a little blue to that to get it a little darker. So I'm adding viridian and ultramarine blue here to give it a very dark greenish blue color for these little evergreen trees that are sort of sitting back here. There's a couple of them here. There's one on the other side. I want to make this come out on the other side of that tree that's over there and keep it fairly dark in there. All right. Something like that. There's a couple more on the other side. Pick up some ultra blue and viridian. Over here we've got a couple of them. I'll just block those in. They really come down on the, they're on this front bank here. They're not in the background back there. They're on the front bank. Another one here. Pick up some darks, black. So you're seeing me experiment with these colors. I've never really used these colors very much at all. So I'm trying to learn how the colors work together, how they mix. But this is what I find challenging and interesting. There's a little tree back in here. Okay. All right, another little stopping point here. We can step back and see where are we, what's it look like. All right. I think I got this guy in there pretty well. There's some darks along here that I see that are sort of sticking up, pointing up. All right. And just a few bit of grays over here. There's some brush and stuff. I think I've got that pretty well blocked in, but I want to put a little bit darker color over here. All right. Over here, I want to gray this out a little bit. All right. This water is really an interesting color. It's not question for you, what color is water? I've asked this before. Some of you who've watched me before know the answer. Water really has no color. It only reflects what's above it, what's under it, what's in it, or what's around it. So when you see blue water in a painting, it usually means it's reflecting a blue sky. But if you only use blue, you're not really reflecting reality all that much. So this water is really has no hardly any blue in it. It's got purples and make sure I got all the color out of this brush. I still got some yellows in there. So let's see what we can do here with these. I'm still just using these two brushes. I'm using a number 6 bristle bright and a number 6 bristle flat. These are polycarbonate bristles, so they're synthetic bristles. All right. The background, let's see, let's put this water in, see what we can get going here with it. Usually with water, I like to have that liquid white on there, which I've already put in. Excuse me. What tells you it's water? Usually the vertical reflections tell you it's water. So if I start doing this, pulling down these dark colors like this, pulling down some bright colors here like that, you will start thinking that looks like water back there, because I'm using really an optical illusion to fool your eye. Does that look like water? Not exactly. But let's put some dark on the bank here. Very dark. So now, as we start seeing this, pull down a little bit of that darkness in there, you're starting to see a little more idea of water, I hope. Put a little purple in there just to reinforce it. Coming here. I'll show you the trick really in a minute that makes it really look like water. This water is gray, it's got browns in it. Violet in it, picking up this, a lot of violet there on my brush. Kind of have some yellows because we got all this yellow stuff reflecting back here. Got some greens, or reflecting those greens and some dark So putting this underpainting of a little bit of white into a liquid white that's sort of just setting there helps tell you this is something smooth. It lets the paint flow very nicely over this so that it makes a nice vertical reflection. A little more here. And I'm hitting it, leaving a little scumbling effect. I'm letting you see the canvas too there. It's really, you can't see that on the camera, I'm sure, but it actually is leaving little horizontal lines floating through there that you can, I can see up close. I'm not sure you can see it where you are, but the idea is to pull all this down, get a nice sheen on there that makes it look like it's a real calm body of water. Water's flowing, but it's just not moving very fast anywhere. That up, pick up some yellows up here, oranges. A bit of the reddish colors up here, maybe, like that, from there. A bit of yellows on top. So I'm just sort of, I'm not trying to paint exact mirror image of what's above, but I'm putting enough colors in here that you can see the reflection. A lot of leaves floating around. We'll come back maybe and put a few more leaves and stuff on top of this water in a minute, but that's just, that's got to be grayer than that. A bit too dark. Too yellow, rather. Okay, now let's see if we can come back and put in, using my other brush here, what I do with it, there it is. I put in some more dark on the banks here to make sure that we have it well defined. There's all kind of debris and limbs and junk floating down here, laying at the bottom, sticking in the water. Some are in the water, some are not. Let me come back and put some of those in a minute. But I wanted to get this going. One of the things that I usually do to help make that reflection look a little more real is to take a brush, a big brush, usually a big wide one, and you start putting a little horizontal blur across it like this, just very lightly. Pull across and wipe the brush off, wipe the paint out, and all of a sudden you're getting a nice fuzzy blurred looking water here. Let's do it up here. So it's that combination of those horizontal streaks, horizontal brush strokes, and vertical streaks that make that look so calm and reflective. All right, we'll leave that for now. Let's go back and start seeing if we can work on these trees a little bit. We got a lot of trees to put in, a lot more branches to put in. Need a small brush for my trees. I'm picking up a Royal Langnickel Sable Tech long filbert brush. It's got smaller, has a small width. It's a number, this is a number 6 as well. So you see a 6 in Princeton Catalyst brush and a number 6 in a Royal Langnickel Sable Tech. They're certainly different widths. So when you look at the numbers on brushes, don't just buy a number. Try to get the actual width or dimension of it, if you can get it in inches or so. I'm putting in a tree right there. I'm going to have another tree that's sort of beside this, picking up some black and this burnt umber colors together. Just sort of laying it on top here, letting these things go. Something like that. I need my script liner, the brush I didn't pull out. One of my brushes from my Bob Ross set is a script liner. It has a very narrow fine fibers. You can paint these trees with that. I think I'm going to go get that here in a second. Paint a few more of these and just sort of lay them in with this brush. It's the width of the brush is what makes the width of the tree, but even though I'm putting it sideways, it's still fairly wide. These trees just go off the top of the canvas. A lot of trees back there. So the more you can make that look like that, the more you have a wooded area, heavy wooded area. Okay, let's hold on those for a moment. See if I can get my little script liner here. I'll be right back. There it is. All right. So what I wanted was this little script liner. And by using some either liquid or thinner to get the paint very thin on a brush, you can make some very nice fine lines with this. Like this. Get a lot of paint in the brush and just push it in and make these things go any which way. A jiggly hand is a good idea for some of this. People say, I don't have a steady hand. Well, you don't need a steady hand. You need to jiggle a little bit when you're making tree limbs. They look much better, much more realistic if you jiggle a little bit. Okay, put a few more in here. That come back. I'm going to go back in this. That might be good enough for now. Just see what that looks like in a minute. But right now, I'm going to leave it like that. There's a few more that come out here like this and actually stick up above. Just as you raise your brush, pull it away from the canvas, and you will get that really nice fine line that looks so beautiful. All right, some more thinner, more color. Back in here, there's tons of trees, a lot of small branches, big branches. Pick up some of the purple. I'm going to get a little, this, purple gets some nice thinner in it to thin it down. The amount of thinner you have is determines how thick or thin the line can be when you're using a brush like this. Twist it around, get a nice point on it, really thin point like that, and you can do wonders. Hundreds of trees back in here. Pick up a little of this white to lighten it up a little bit. We need a little grayer color. It's almost too dark. It needs to be a little gray in some areas. There, that's a little better. Okay. Over here, we've got a lot of trees in the background there, so I'll just show a few there. All right, let's take this big old tree. We've got a big old tree on the left side. It's got a lot of color in it. I don't know if I can do this whole thing with this brush or not. I'm gonna give it a try. Gotta keep it thin. If I used a fatter brush, I could do it faster. But I got this brush going. I got the nice thin paint from all the liquid I've been putting in it. You'll probably see it's really glistening on the canvas here. So let's just keep working on this. We have these trees that are limbs that are broken off and laying across the water down here like this. I'm gonna put him in like that. So you see these trees up here have this broken, looks like a limb is broken off, might be that limb. And we have another one on the other side that's sort of laying down like this. Get a little more purple in him. Right here. That's almost too light. It needs to be darker. You can see it. I see it going into the water there. And maybe there's a little dark edge on the top. Helps you determine that. Something like that. I may want to fine-tune that a little bit in a minute, but right now we'll leave it for that. Over here, we're still a little canvas to cover. And then there's stuff in the background back here as well. A lot of trees and over here and more over there. All right, step back, take a look. Okay. Starting to get that look that I'm reaching for. Few branches and stuff inside this tree here. That's almost too dark, so we can sort of lighten it up. Use your finger. Finger painting is fun. Put a little color in there and then smudge it around a little bit. You get some nice, interesting edges and stuff that's hard to get with a brush even. Right. It's not dark enough over there. I hope you're painting along with me. This is a lot of fun. Make yourself a nice, easy scene here. These go right off the canvas up here. All right. That's good enough for now. Put a few more things at the bottom here. We'll come back and touch that up with some more stuff. Okay, so got that going. One of the other little tricks we can use, which I haven't tried yet, is this idea of scraping in some trees in the background. You always use this palette knife. Any palette knife will do, but if you have the canvas, you can actually do something like this and scrape out some trees that look like they're... You really pull that gray through because the canvas behind it has got this gray on it, so you can actually see, rather than trying to paint in a gray tree, you just scrape in one. All right, something like that. Put a couple over here, maybe. All right, something like that helps out this tell the story. I think it's time to come back now and see if we can put in a few more of the branches and the trees over what we have here, so we don't look like these branches are all laying on top. What you want to do is then come back with the colors that are behind them and start putting in some leaves on top now. So I'm using my this little number 6 long filbert, it's called. And just popping in some colors on top of here. Got some white in there. There's a whole bunch of orange in the photograph. Sometimes the photographs are good to remind you that you've got to put some other colors in here that you may have forgotten. Like in this area right here, we got a bunch of leaves that sort of cover up the trunk of that tree. Because I got all that wet paint under there, it's not covering up as well as I thought, but you can still make it out and add some highlights to it. the white. And here I'll put in a few more highlights. If I get this orange color that I like here. Okay, something like this is what we're trying to do. Over here, similar thing on the other side. Pick up some more of this yellow-orange color and see if we can drop in some ochre. I'm just using the brush and sort of making small, short brush strokes with it to make these leaves and back here. So some of the leaves are on top, some are behind. Pick up a little green in there maybe to see if I can change the color so it's not quite so orange or yellow. Orange. Just a few more highlights in here. Make sure this stands out in front of that behind it. I want you to know this is in front of what's behind it. I don't want to blend together. So the values get too close together, you end up with confusing areas of the painting. So I'm trying to straighten it out right here now. So I want you to think this is definitely in front of the one behind it. This is definitely wrong color. There's a shadow that goes here. This is sort of a, greenish. I even see some pink in there a little bit in here. I want this to stand out so that you definitely know that this is a bank in the foreground and it's got a little tree limb laying there that's sticking out. Okay, how about this bank here? Let's see, I want some more, I need some more vertical strokes here to make this look more like a bank. It looks kind of, not sure what it is going on here, but let's see if we can fix it up a little bit here with some greens and some yellows. I want this tree to be fastened in the ground, so we have some things going up like this from the bank, which helps define that as a bank. Something like that. Another dark color in here like this. Okay, we're doing very well here with this painting. Get rid of a little more, clean my brush a little bit more. This area over here, I'm going to just, since I put some more paint there, I'm going to just sort of pull down some specific streaks here. And what I want to do is pull down some of this color from the tree down here in the water. It's definitely going to be reflecting down here, right? Something like that. It's going to help tell you this is water as well. See what that looks like from a distance. Oh yes, that's right. And if I take my big brush here that's got the big, and come back and give me one of these little, like that, sort of just blur it a little bit so that it doesn't look like it's all, I don't want you to see just, I don't want to repaint the tree in the water. I want you to see that blurriness. All right, we do have stuff laying in the water here. We have spots of leaves and all kinds of debris laying out here. Different colors, browns and stuff laying out here in the water. You could spend a lot of time doing this if you want to draw every little leaf. And I don't want to spend that much time on it, but I do want you to see we've got a log. This log doesn't stand out too well to me. I'm going to try to see if I can make it almost too straight. I want it to have some personality here. This one over here is pretty straight as well, but let's see if I can get him a little bit darker in some areas. Okay, and this little log, as you would guess, has a reflection. It sort of goes back this way. It should be the angle of that log going back this way. Make it look right. You should see that. You should see this little log's reflection down here somewhere. I'm trying to make it 3D. You see that log. You want to see this log's reflection. Again, make our lines run through it horizontally. Okay, that's just enough to tell you that that's lying in the water. Hopefully that tells you that. Okay, let's get on this other bank over here and see if we can finish it up. A lot of weeds and all kind of junk in here. Picking up some grasses. Fairly impressionistic. I don't want you to spend a lot of time looking over here. But see if that helps define it just a little better. Some more the dark colors down here and pull them up. The mixture of these brush strokes, going light strokes and then putting dark under them, help sell the idea there's a lot of weeds and stuff sticking up here. Over here the same way, I didn't put enough dark over here, but that's the idea. Here we got a bunch of bushes and stuff sticking up over here. I'll see what I can do with this. Get some more of the All right, let me look at that and think about that again. Looking pretty good, I think. Not sure what I would do to improve it other than maybe throw a little more debris down. More leaves and things over here on the right side. We got a lot of stuff that we could put in over here that would help tell the story of this water. It's just sort of collecting a lot of stuff over here. These could have some rocks over here. I don't know if I want to take the time to make look like rocks or not. Maybe putting a little bit of a highlight on top. Some of these would help define that a little bit, maybe. So a lot of little things going on. Actually, there's a bunch of little white flowers. If I look at this painting, if I see a lot of little white flowers kind of speckling the bank over here. So I'm going to just put some of those in. I see something every time I look at this photograph. I see more little details. I don't want to over detail it, but I certainly want to get some of the highlights in to help make it more interesting. I got an area here. There's a rule that I follow based on what I've learned from my teachers, that you don't want to have an area that's got two square inches of your paper that just, or your canvas that has really nothing going on. If you have an area that's just sort of bland, try to do something. Put a rock in there, put a tree in there, put something in there to help make it look like there's something going on. I'm gonna go back and get my really thin brush here and script liner and see if I can put in a few more little trees that are closer to the bank here. Maybe something that sort of sticks up like this that helps fill that area in over there. This is an area of the painting where I don't want to have a lot of interest over here. You don't want to put a lot of detail on this side of the painting over here because you don't want that to pull the viewer's eye. So let's leave it abstract, but put a little bit of detail in there to sort of fill it out. What else do I need to do? Maybe there's just a little few more branches that I could stick in here to help tell this story a little bit better. It's a little bit too... No, that didn't work. Go back and get me some yellow and put in there. There we go. All right. If I keep messing with it, I'll make it worse. So I'm going to stop here very soon. Let's see, put a few more highlights in here, maybe. All right, one more step back, one more look. What's it look like on video? And I hope that has given you enough to follow along and paint. So without any more to do, I will say thank you for watching. And till I see you again, this is Larry Hamilton saying so long for now. Goodbye.